isn't the one to draw attention to herself. Cynthia, on the other hand, all three of them, Anne, Marco, and Cynthia's mild-mannered husband, Graham, are watching her as if fascinated. Marco, in particular, can't seem to take his eyes off of Cynthia. She leans in a little too.
Other couple, so they're at home. Okay. Anne can't focus on the conversation.
your acne set in. She is not a good mother. So what if the sitter canceled? They should have bought Cora with them, put her in the portable playpen. But Cynthia has said, no children. It was the adult evening for Graham's birthday, which is another reason Anne has come to dislike Cynthia. Cynthia, who was once a good friend. Cynthia is not baby friendly. Who says that a 6-month-old baby isn't welcome to a dinner party? How had Anne ever let Marco persuade her to let her know it was okay? It was irresponsible. She wonders what the other mothers in her mom's group would think if she ever told them. We left our 6-month-old baby at home alone and went to a party next door. She imagines all their jaws dropping in shock and uncomfortable silence. Uncomfortable. But she would never tell them. She'd be shunned. She and Marco had argued about it before the party. When the sitter had called and canceled, Anne had offered to stay home with the baby. She hadn't wanted to go to dinner anyway, but Marco was having none of it. You can't just stay home, he insisted. When they argued about it in their kitchen, I'm fine staying home, she said, her voice lowered. She didn't want Cynthia to hear them through the shared wall arguing about going to her party. It would be good for you to get out, Marco continued, lowering his voice, and then he added, you know what the doctor said. All night she's been trying to decide whether that last comment was mean-spirited or self-interested or whether he was simply trying to help. Finally, she given in. Marco persuaded her with that monitor on the next door that they could hear the baby anytime. She stirred or woke. They would check on her every half an hour. Nothing bad would happen. It's 1 o'clock. She should be checking on Cora now or just try to get Marco to leave. She wants to go home to bed. She wants this night to end. She pulls her husband's arm. Marco, she urges, we should leave. It's 1 o'clock. Oh, don't go yet, Cynthia says. It's not that late. She obviously doesn't want the party to be over. She doesn't want Marco to leave. She shouldn't mind at all. Anne left, though. Anne is pretty sure. Maybe not for you, Anne says. She manages to sound a little stiff, even though she's drunk. But I have to be up early to feed the baby. Poor you, Cynthia says. And for some reason, this infuriates Anne. Cynthia has no children, nor has she wanted any. And she and Graham are childless by choice. Getting Marco to leave the party is difficult. He seems determined to stay. He's having too much fun. But Anne is growing anxious. Just one more. Marco says to Cynthia, holding up his glass, avoiding his wife's eyes. He is in a strangely boisterous mood tonight. It seems most forced. Anne wonders why he has been quiet lately at home, distracted, even moody. But tonight with Cynthia, he's the life of the party. For some time now, Anne has sensed that something is wrong. If only he would tell her what it is. He isn't telling her much of anything these days. He's shutting her out, or maybe he's withdrawing from her because of her depression or her baby blues. He's disappointed in her. Oh, is it tonight? He clearly prefers the beautiful, bubbly, sparkly Cynthia. Anne notices the time and loses all patience. I'm going to go. I was supposed to go check on the baby at 1. She looks at Marco. You stay as late as you like. She adds, her voice tight. Marco looks sharply at her, his eyes glittering. Suddenly, She cries all night and spoils your evening. I'll be sure to invite you when she's teething. They leave quickly. After that, they have no baby gear to gather up, just themselves and purse and the baby monitor, which she shoves into it. Cynthia looks annoyed at their swift departure. Graham is neutral, and they make their way out the impressively heavy front door and down the steps, and grabs a hold of the elaborately carved handrail and helps her keep her balance. It is just a few paces along the sidewalk until they are at their own front stairs with a similar handrail and equally impressive front door, and is walking slightly ahead of Marco and not speaking. She may not speak to him for the rest of the night. She marches up the steps and stops dead. "What?" Marco says, coming up behind her, his voice tense. Anne is staring. The front door is ajar. It is open about 3 inches. "I know I locked it," Anne says, her voice shrill. Marco says tersely, "Maybe you forgot. You had a lot to drink." But Anne isn't listening. She's inside and running up the staircase and down the hall to the baby's room, with Marco right at her heels. When she gets to the baby's room, she sees the crib, the empty crib, and she screams. Chapter 2. Oh my god. Okay. Anne feels her scream inside her own head and reverberating off the walls. Her scream is everywhere. Then she falls silent and stands in front of the empty crib, rigid, her hand to her mouth. Marco fumbles with the light switch. They both stare at the empty crib where the baby should be. It is impossible that she's not here. There's no way Cora could have gotten out the crib by herself. She is barely 6 months old. Call the police. Anne whispers and then throws up, the vomit cascading over her fingers and onto the hardwood floor as she bends over. The baby's room, painted a soft butter yellow with stencils of baby lambs frolicking on the walls, immediately falls with the smell of bile and panic. Marco doesn't move. Anne looks up at him. He is paralyzed in shock, staring at the empty crib as if he can't believe it. Anne sees the fear and guilt in his eyes and starts to wail, a horrible keening sound like an animal in pain. Marco still doesn't budge. Anne bolts across the hall to the bedroom, grabs the phone off the bedside table, and dials 911. Her hands shaking, getting vomit all over the phone. Marco finally snaps out of it. She can hear him walking rapidly around the second floor of the house while she stares across the hall at the empty crib. He checks the bathroom at the top of the stairs and then passes quickly by her on his way to search for the spare bedroom and the last room down the hall, the one that they have turned into an office. But even as he does, Anne wanders in a detached way while he is looking there. It is as if the part of her mind has split off and he is thinking logically. It is not like their baby is mobile on their own. She is not in the bathroom or the spare bedroom or the office. Someone has taken her. When the emergency operator answers, Anne cries, "Someone has taken her baby." She is barely able to calm herself enough to answer the operator's questions. "I understand, ma'am. Try to stay calm. The police are on their way," the operator assures her. "I understand, ma'am. Try to stay calm. The police are on their way." Anne hangs up the phone. Her whole body is trembling. She feels like she is going to be sick again. It occurs to her how it would look. They left the baby alone in the house. Was it illegal? It must be. How would they explain it? Marco appears at the bedroom door, pale and sick-looking. "This is your fault," Anne screams, wild-eyed, and pushes past him. She rushes into the bathroom onto the top of the stairs and drops up and throws up again, and this time into a pedestal sink, and then washes the mess from her shaking hands and rinses her mouth. She catches a glimpse of herself in the mirror. Marco is standing right behind her. Their eyes meet in the mirror. "I'm sorry," he whispers. "I'm so sorry. It's my fault." And he is sorry, she can tell. Even so, Anne brings up her hand and smashes the reflection of his face in the mirror. The mirror shatters and she breaks down, sobbing. He tries to take her in his hands, but she pushes him away and runs down the stairs. Her hand is bleeding. arrived in a composed man with a well-cut dark suit. A uniformed officer treats him with deference and looks up, meeting his piercing blue eyes, and wonders who he is. He approaches and sits down in front of the armchair across from Anne and Marco and introduces himself as Detective Rasbach. And then he leans forward. "Tell me what happened." Anne immediately forgets the detective name, or rather isn't registered at all. She only catches Detective. She looks at him, encouraged by the frank intelligence behind his eyes. He will help them. He will help them get Cora back. She tries to think, but she can't think. She is frantic and numb at the same time. She simply stares at the detective's sharp eyes and let Marco do the talking. "We were next door," Marco begins, clearly agitated, "at the neighbor's," and then he stops. "Yes," the detective says. Marco hesitates. "Where was the baby?" the detective asked. Marco doesn't answer. He doesn't want to say.
Person
smashed, Ginny tells him. Razbeck nods. He hasn't been upstairs yet. Anything else? Ginny shakes his head. Nothing so far. The house looks clean. Nothing else taken, apparently. We'll know from a forensics in a few hours. Okay, Razbeck says, handing the vial of pills to Jennings. He returns to the couple on the sofa and resumes his questioning. He looks at the husband, Marco. Is it okay if I call you Marco? What did you do after you checked on the baby at 12:30? I went back to the party, Marco says. I had a cigarette in the neighbor's backyard. Were you alone when you had your cigarette? No, Cynthia came out with me. Marco flushes. Razbeck noticed she's the neighbor who had us over for dinner. Razbeck turns his attention to his wife. She is an attractive woman with fine features and glossy brown hair, but right now she looks colorless. You don't smoke, Miss Gandhi? No, I don't, but Cynthia does. Anne says, I was sitting at the dining room table with Graham, her husband. He hates cigarette smoke, and it was his birthday, and I thought it would be rude to leave him alone inside, and then inexplicably, she volunteers. Cynthia has been flirting with Marco all evening, and I felt bad for Graham. I see, Razbeck said. He studies the husband, who looks utterly miserable. He also looks nervous and guilty. Razbeck turns to him. So you were outside in the backyard next door shortly after 12:30. Any idea how long you were out there? Marco shakes his head helplessly. Maybe 15 minutes, give or take. Did you see anything or hear anything? What do you mean? The husband seems to be in some kind of shock. He is slurring his words slightly. Razbeck wonders just how much alcohol he's had. Razbeck spells it out for him. Anyone apparently took your baby sometime around 12:30 and 1:27. You were outside in the backyard, the next door, for a few minutes, shortly after 12:30. He watches the husband, waits for him to put it together. To my mind, it is unlikely that anyone could carry a baby out your front door in the middle of the night. But the front door was open, Anne says. I didn't see anything, Marco says. There's a lane running behind the houses on the side of the street, Detective Razbeck says. Marco nods. Did you notice anyone using that lane at the time? Did you hear anything? A car? I don't think so, Marco says. I'm sorry, I didn't see or hear anything. He covers his face with his hands again. I wasn't paying attention. Detective Razbeck had already checked out the area quietly before coming inside and interviewing the parents. He thinks it is unlikely, but not possible, that a stranger would carry a sleeping child out the front door of a house on a street like this and risk being seen. The houses aren't attached row houses set close to the sidewalk. The street is well lit and there's a fair bit of vehicular and foot traffic, even late at night. So it is odd, perhaps, that he's being deliberately misled. The front door was open. The forensic team is dusting for fingerprints now, but somehow Razbeck doesn't think they'll find anything. The back holds more potential. Most of the houses, including the Contis, have a single detached garage opening to the lane. Behind the house, the backyards are long and narrow, fenced in between, and most the Contis have trees and shrubs and gardens. It is relatively dark back there, but there are no streetlights as there are in the front. It is a dark night with no moon. Whoever has taken the child, if he had come out in the Contis' back door, would he have been able to walk across the backyard to the garage? With access from there to the lane, the chances of being seen carrying an abducted child out the back door to a waiting vehicle are much less than the chances of being seen carrying an abducted child out the front door. The house, yard, and garage are being thoroughly searched by the Razbeck's team. So far, they have found no sign of the missing baby. The Conti's garage is empty, and the garage door has been left wide open to the lane. It's possible that even if someone had been sitting out on the patio next door, he or she might not have noticed anything, but not likely, which narrows the window of abduction between 12:45 and 1:27 a.m. Are you aware that your motion detector isn't working? Razbeck asks. What? The husband says, startled. You have a motion detector on your back door, a light that should go on when someone approaches it. Are you aware that it's not working? No, the wife whispers. The husband shakes his head vigorously. No, it was working when I checked on her. What's wrong with it? The bulb has shade paler, if that was even possible. His pallor is quite striking. We are hoping we will get some shoe prints or tire tracks from the garage, Razback adds. You make it sound like this was planned, the mother says. Do you think it wasn't? Razback asks her. I don't know. I guess I thought Cora was taken because we left her alone in the house. That it was a crime of opportunity, like if someone had snatched her from the park when I wasn't looking. Razback nods, as if trying to understand it from her point of view. I see what you mean, he says. For example, a mother leaves her child playing in the backyard while she fetches an ice cream from the ice cream truck. The child is snatched while her back is turned. It happens, he pauses, but surely you realize the difference here. She looks back at him blankly. He has to remember that she is probably in shock, but he sees this sort of thing all the time. It is his job. He is analytical, not sentimental. He must be if he is to be effective. He will find this child dead or alive, or he will find whoever took her. He tells the mother, his voice matter of fact, the difference is whoever took your baby probably knew she was alone in the house. The parents look at each other, but nobody knew. The mother whispers, of course, Razback adds, it is possible that she might have been taken even if you were sound asleep in your bedroom. We don't know for sure. The parents would like to believe that this isn't their fault after all, for leaving their baby alone, that this might have happened anyway. Razback adds, do you always leave the garage door open like that? The husband answers, sometimes. Wouldn't you close the garage door at night to prevent theft? We don't keep anything valuable in the garage, the husband says. If the car is in there, we generally lock the door. But we don't keep much in there otherwise. All my tools are in the basement. This is a nice neighborhood, but people break into garages here all the time. So what's the point of locking it? Razback nods. Then he asks, what kind of car do you have? It's an Audi, Marco says. Why? I like to have a look. May I have the keys? Razback asks. Marco and Anne regard each other in confusion. Then Marco gets up and goes to the side table near the front door and grabs a set of keys from a bowl. He hands them over to the detective silently and sits back down. Thank you, Razback says. Then he leans forward and says deliberately, we'll find out who did this. They stare back at him, meeting his eyes. My belly, I'm sorry. The mother's entire face swollen from crying, and the eyes, the father's eyes puffy and bloodshot with distress and drink, his face pasty. Razback nods to Jennings, and together they leave the house to go check the car. The couple sit on the sofa silently and watch them go. Anne doesn't know what to make of the detective. All this about their car, he seems to be insinuating something. She knows that when a wife goes missing, the husband is usually the prime suspect, and probably vice versa. But when a child goes missing, are the parents usually the prime suspect? Surely not. Who could harm their own child? Besides, they have solid alibis. They can be accounted for by Cynthia and Graham. There is no obviously way they could have taken and hidden their own daughter, and why would they? She is aware that the neighborhood is being searched, that there are police officers going up and down the streets, knocking on doors, interviewing people, roused from their beds. Marco has provided the police with a recent photo of Cora, just taken a few days ago. The photo shows a happy blonde baby girl with blue eyes, smiling up at the camera. Anne is angry at Marco. She wants to scream at him, pummel him with her fist, but the house is full of police officers, so she doesn't care. When she looks at his pale, bleak face, she sees that he is already blaming himself. She knows she can't survive this on her own. She turns to him and collapses into his chest, sobbing. His arms come up around her, and he hugs her tightly, tightly, tightly. She can feel him shaking, but can feel the pain thumping in his heart. She tells herself that together they will get through this. The police will find Cora, and they will get their daughter back, and if they don't, she will never forgive him. Detective Razback, in his lightweight summer suit, steps out the front door of the Contis house and down the steps into the hot summer night, closed, followed by Detective Jennings. They have worked together before. They have seen some things that they would not be able to forget. Together, they walk toward the opposite What's your take? Razbeck answers quietly, I'm not optimistic. Razbeck puts on a pair of gloves that Jennings hands him and opens the door on the driver's side. He looks briefly inside and then silently walks to the back of the car. Jennings follows. Razbeck pops open the trunk, and the two detectives look inside. It's empty, very clean. The car is just over a year old. It still looks new. Love that new car smell, Jennings says. Clearly the child isn't there. That doesn't mean she hadn't been there. However, briefly, perhaps forensic investigation will reveal fibers from a pink onesie, DNA from the baby, a hair trace or jewel, or blood. Without a body, they have a tougher case to make. But no parents ever put their baby in the trunk with good intentions. If they find a trace of the missing child in the trunk, he will see that the parents rot in hell. Because if there's anything that Razbeck has learned in his years on the job, it is that people are capable of almost anything. Razbeck is aware that the baby could have gone missing at any time before the dinner party. He has yet to question the parents in detail about the previous day, has yet to determine who, rather than the parents, last saw the child alive. But he will find out. Perhaps there is a mother's helper who comes in, a cleaning lady or a neighbor, someone who saw the baby alive and well earlier that day. He will establish when the baby was last known to be alive and work forward from there. This leaving the monitor on, checking every half an hour while they dine next door, the disabled motion detector, the open front door. It could all simply be an elaborate fiction, a carefully constructed fabrication of the parents to provide them with an alibi to throw the authorities off the scent. They may have killed the baby at any time earlier that day, either deliberately or by accident, and put her in the trunk and disposed of the body before going to the party next door. Or if they were still thinking clearly, they may not have put her in the trunk at all, but in the car seat. A dead baby might not look that different from a sleeping baby, depending on how they killed her. Razbeck knows that he is cynic. He hadn't started out that way. He says to Jennings, bring in the cadaver dogs. That is it. So you guys, that is the one, chapters 1-3. Let me know what you think. That's really all I can say. I don't want to make this video too long, but it's probably like already long. But that is chapters 1-3. This is The Couples Next Door, and I will see you for the next reading. I'm not sure if I should